Just to say a few words for Dimitris Papanikolaou, who is an associate professor of modern Greek studies at the University of Oxford and fellow of St. Cross College in UK. His research focuses on the ways modern Greek literature opens a dialogue with other cultural forms, especially Greek popular culture, as well as other literatures and cultures. He's committed to literary and cultural theory and the new perspectives they offer for the study of literature. And he has written several books, among the monographs Singing Poets, Literature and Popular Music in France and Greece. Those made like me, Queer Kabafi and the Poetic of Sexuality, which is the newest one. And he's currently writing a book on the representation of the family in recent Greek novel, theater and film. So your lecture about new queerness is our next topic, so I will pass it over to you.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for coming, and even the late comers. Thank you so much for inviting me. Very hospitable place, great organization, and I very much like the format. Thanks to the organizers, to you, I've come here, and I'm very interested in this kind of format you're doing. Five-day
events. We're doing similar things in Greece. We're doing similar things in the UK. The recent crisis and the social movements that are springing out of it is something that we have to find new ways in order to discuss. So I suppose the reason I'm here, somehow keynoting the gender day, or at least giving this kind of longer lecture on the gender day, is because, I don't know, is it because I recently published a book on Kavafi, who is a very central Greek poet, a very central homosexual poet for the kind of homosexual literature, if you want to frame it like that, of the 20th century, who has not been discussed as such in Greece. So I recently published a book that sort of caused a little bit of a crisis of its own in Greece, and perhaps we could address that in the discussion, for which I will leave enough time. I suppose the reason here too is because I have got a story to tell related to gender, theory, queer cultures, and the effort to frame those in a Greek cultural context, in the Greek public sphere. This is what I will try to address today. It's been some time I've been thinking about and around the crisis, and also I've been thinking about gender hierarchies, queer cultures, and the crisis too, and this is what my topic today will be. Now, the reason, the title of today's lecture is a little bit autobiographic and self-referential, and I apologize for that in advance. So it goes back to a paper I wrote 10 years ago. It's published in 2008, but the first lecture I gave on it was 2004. It's exactly 10 years from now that I first lectured on this kind of idea, New Queer Greece, and this was based on two films that at the time were still very much watched. If you Google that title or New Queer Greece and my name, you find the paper is free online. At the time, we people would still discuss films such as the Constantine Yanaris films, and also such as From the Edge of the City. Constantine Yanaris is a new queer film director, well known first for his work in Britain, and then for his work in Greece, a Greek queer film director. And then also films like Head On, the Greek-Australian film Head On, not the the German film with the same title, which addressed issues such as gay identity or queer identity and national identity in the frame of Greekness and Greece. So at the time, 10 years ago, what I was actually thinking was that these films basically address a new audience. Not only do they show a new frame of identity, that is, new queer Greeks, but by showing it in the way they do, they actually reframe the audience, they position the audience in a new position that is the position of a new queer Greece. What I was basically saying then was that we are creating, in terms of audience and work, a new queer Greece that is at the same time a Greece that redefines itself in terms of identity, national identity, belonging, and gender hierarchy. Okay? I can see you talking, and I'm here. So this is where I'm starting to tell you the story of today. 10 years ago, oh, I should also, okay, let me also tell you a little bit about this image. Have it in your mind when, as I'm speaking, the Greek speak between you and those very filmy between you would identify this picture. It's coming, it's a very central scene from the film Strela, or A Woman's Way, by Panos Koutras, a queer film that was out 2011, if I'm not wrong, December 2010. Now, this is a very central scene from the film. You don't need to see more of it, just the image. Strela is a transsexual who falls in love with her father. And this is towards the end of the film. She takes a very long walk in Athens. Those of you into film, a very long take, or actually two long takes, one from behind and then from the front. She basically walks in the center of Athens. It is December, the lights have gone on, there is something happening there, and everyone, when we first watched the film in 2010, December, thought that this is immediately after the 2008 events in December, or a little bit later. That is the beginning of the crisis Greece. That is, Strela, the transsexual, she's become now a prototypical kind of reference for us, the kind of prototypical Greek transsexual falling in love with her father in a very kind of tragic way, walking in crisis Athens. As a matter of fact, these scenes, for those of you who will go back and watch the film again, were actually shot just a couple of days before the December 2008 events in Greece. So Strela is walking in Athens just before the crisis erupted. Yeah, just remember that. 10 years ago, I felt the need to talk about new queer Greece, about a new queer Greece that I thought at the time was coming together. I believe many other people, some of you, some among you as well, felt that too. And it was a sentiment that kept growing in us in the years that came after. It was the decade of the 2000s. Already years after a number of developments in Greece that had made us believe that a new Greek culture was more inclusive, and in its inclusivity included queer expression as one of its central elements. Konstantin Yannaris, one of the pioneers of new queer film in the UK, new queer film is a movement that was very much supported centrally by the BFI and Channel 4. So Yannaris was quite well known in the late 80s and early 90s. So Konstantin Yannaris, one of the pioneers of new queer film in the UK, had already migrated to Athens. With him, a sense that a new queer Greek film was not only possible, but was supported and up and coming. It was there and it was coming. Stereo Nova, an electronica group that had been considered paradigmatic for the vibrant yet marginal queer scene of the late 1980s and early 1990s, was becoming again paradigmatic, or remaining paradigmatic, only now addressing a younger generation and a much bigger crossover audience. It was the decade of the years 2000. The new media that was springing from every corner included as their necessary new voice in Greece, I'm still talking about Greece, a queer columnist, often many, many more. You wouldn't have a trendy new newspaper or magazine without queer columns in 2004, say. And Malvina Karali, a famous columnist for years, the famous columnist, now turned political commentator in 2004-2003, incorporated in her hugely followed daily TV show words identified with the Greek homosexual lingo kaliarda, a form of Greek polari, which had thus migrated or was migrating from subcultural expression to neocultural trend. That was the year 2004, for instance. And in the Olympic Games, the contract for the opening and closing ceremonies was offered to Dimitris Papanikolaou and his team from Ομάδα Εδάφους, a dance theater group with identifiably queer artistic vocabulary and often thematics. Again, those of you from Greece or with a relationship to Greek culture know that Ομάδα Εδάφους has done, among other things, the only big show on the victims of AIDS in Greece. In 2004, they were given that kind of huge acclaim and huge kind of stage that was the opening of the 2004 Olympic Games. This was a new queer Greece, springing up from every corner. And the enthusiasm of that, perhaps, made us forget the problems it was bringing with it. Its fixation, for instance, with culturally productive gay men, let's face it, and the underrepresentation of lesbians and lesbian Greek cultures. Still, it was the years 2000, the decade of the 2000, and we were not thinking of that. Or its failure to address issues that had been hovering completely outside public view since the 1980s or 90s in Greece, such as the AIDS epidemic and the stigmatization of its victims, or the mourning or the non-mourning of its loss. That was very palpable, it's still very palpable in Greece. We never talked about AIDS. Still, in the decade of 2000, around 2004, 10 years ago, nobody really talked about that. Or nobody talked about the unease with any discussion about institutions, policies, public presence, and the link of homosexuality, and the link between nationality and gender hierarchies. So we were all I was very elated to think that I'm part of a new queer Greece, but we were not talking about issues that were still remaining unsolved. But it was the decade of 2000, and opportunities were coming fast and impressively effective. With time, even new groups emerged that did address issues and were, most importantly, influenced by the more recent waves of queer theory and the new opportunities for counterpublics offered by the new media. Some of the people who actually were very central in those new counterpublics that were emerging in the 2007, 2008, some of them are with you today, and you will see Fita. I understand that you were also kind of you as people that I'm describing now, in a sense. And this is exactly the moment when the crisis hit. Think of that. This is exactly the moment. We were all very happy with our new queer Greece, with all its problems. We even thought the new generation is coming to address issues we had all forgotten in our happiness, and then the crisis came. As is by now a commonplace in Greek critical debates, the crisis did bring with it the strengthening of gender hierarchies already existing in Greek society, often pushed out of view during a previous period of social mobility and Europeanization, but still existing. So the crisis strengthened those gender hierarchies. This strengthening of gender hierarchies, evident in a public discourse after 2008-09, was now obsessed with the survival of the Greek family or the rise of nationalism, is generally taken to be the reason of the concomitant rise in gender-related violence and homophobic attacks that we see in Greece in recent years. It's a big discussion to be had here whether homophobic attacks and gender violence never went away, it's just that now we see it more. But many people, and many people in the center of the critical debate, actually do believe that more violence has come because of the crisis and because gender hierarchies have been strengthened, have been actually more acute, bringing up problems that were there, that were under, but have now resurfaced. Don't forget, and this is also another important issue that most of you know, even if you are not Greek, this is exactly what people do tell me when I give lectures. Don't forget the deadly politics of austerity that seem to converge with a necropolitics, a thanatopolitical strategy of the Greek extreme right, which comes together with the gender violence that I've been talking to you about. It seems that, the Greek extreme right, don't forget, does not conceal the fact that it has been thinking of others as exterminable during the crisis, especially so, and along with the, and that somehow strengthens the violence against also queer people, non-Greek queer people, and to a certain extent also gender violence. This is something that I could discuss with you in the discussion. I'm just flagging up things but in recent years we have seen gender violence rising also because the extreme right is pushing an agenda that says that the others, those who do not conform, are actually to be eliminated. Okay? And this is kind of new as a discourse. I've talked about that a lot in the past, so it could come up in the discussion afterwards. I'm just flagging it up now. Interestingly, the crisis has not only brought forth the most hidden aspects of a Greek patriarchal system that never went away, really, but it has also made us notice in a more sustained fashion now, and actually with a much more analytical, with a new dynamism, with a new willingness to engage the work of avant-garde performers and thinkers that identify as queer and are themselves in contact with queer expression around the world, trying to bridge or trying to put together a discourse that is both anti-neoliberal, transgressive, gender questioning, as it is also national questioning, and anti-far right. Fita, for instance, whose performance we will watch in a moment, were centerpieces in the recent Agora Biennale in Greece, are to an extent doing stuff that are presented in Athens more and more. The point here is they are becoming more, but people like Fita or performances like the one you will watch is becoming more sustained now and more watched, especially because people are understanding that it's now very topical. This is an issue, and new queer expression can answer back to the strengthening of gender hierarchies I've been talking about. or Vasilis Noulas, whose presentation on the Mavili movement you will hear tomorrow, who is one of the many Greek queer directors on the Greek stage at the moment, who are very political, gender analytical, very active, and I think taking people's interest in their work, especially in the context of the crisis as well. I could name a number of other similar developments. New queer movements do spring up, do come up more forcefully in Greece. There are versions of the Pride movements in Athens and Thessaloniki that are actually more radicalized at the moment. And film is bringing a number of new voices that use queer vocabularies, and in that you could also say that films that are not necessarily gay can be seen from a queer perspective, such as Dogtooth or Attenberg, identifiably, I think, queer, or at least the films that could be read from a queer viewpoint. And all this is to say that a certain answer to what is happening in recent years is coming from queer movements at the moment in Greece. So the point up to here is that for the first time in Greece, it looks as if, while homophobia lurks under every corner, homophobia that is everywhere, the queers are also everywhere. Yeah? Okay, so that's kind of the scheme I wanted to. I remind you a little bit what I've just said. We're very happy, New Queer Greece. Then we realized, no, New Queer Greece was never a full project, a very unfinished project, New Queer Greece. The crisis came, all this homophobia, all these attacks, blah, blah, blah. Suddenly we realized that there are things there to talk about, but yes, we did come together. Yes, there is a lot of discussion happening now in Greece. Yes, there is from performance to analysis to critical theory to debates to the pride and political debates regarding gender are there to answer back. That's my point. And here I come to the second part of the lecture and perhaps a little bit of an argument that I want to share with you today. It seems to me, and I want to share this as a thought with you, that all new debates on gender sexuality on Greek society at the moment and in the frame of the crisis are exactly being conducted within the frame of this crisis and are seen as pressing issues, beholding a society in danger, in need of modernization, or in a state of exception. I could go on debating this with you or supporting this. It is a claim I think that is quite strong and true. It seems that every debate now in terms of gender and sexuality in Greece is happening within the frame of the crisis, talking about a country that is very, very kind of needs to catch up, or a country that's in a state of exception. In some way, from whichever corner you come, you get crisis and gender together. This is not necessarily a bad thing. What I want to say is that the debate seems to be adopting, for this reason, extremely oppositional terms. A recently emerging backlash coming from a traditionalist, patriarchal, and homophobic Greece, on the one hand, in contrast to a dynamic of modern and progressive queer Greece, on the other hand. The traditionalists, the right wings, the whatever, the backwards, and the queers, or the queer friendlies, or whatever, you name it. For instance, for those of you with Greek and following Greek things, the recent discussion or the recent scandal about the writer Auguste Corto, who was publicly derided on air in a radio station for having declared his love for his husband, He called his boyfriend my husband, and anyway, there's more to that story. But anyway, and then there was these two men, two very, very macho commentators on radio, and were poking fun at that, and there was a huge uproar against that, against the radio show. The show stopped, and all that. That event, for instance, was immediately framed as a backwards Greece versus a very progressive queer Greece. Yeah, whoever was progressive was pro the writer and gayness or whatever else, and declaring publicly homosexuality and love for one's husband and all that. And the two commentators were the baddies. And the same happens with every time a public figure or a church figure comes out to sort of throw a homophobic comment, etc. This is not a problem. I'm just saying, or rather, this is not something I say as a bad thing necessarily. Obviously, all these homophobic attacks, in discursive or in terms of violence, happen, and there is a discourse that goes against it. I just want to share a couple of thoughts about some problems I find with this immediate framing that we make in the crisis, and this kind of debate, this kind of polarization between, on the one, traditionalist backwards Greece, and on the other hand, progressive, pro-queer Greece. So the 5 points to complicate the picture. I'm not denying anything, and I'm not going against what is happening necessarily. I'm just going to complicate the picture just to. Point one, complicating point one. Traditional homophobic on the one hand versus progressive, progressively queer on the other seems to be taking everything in, to be eating everything in terms of analysis. For all it's worth, though, there are still problems exactly with that polarization that we tend to forget. The first problem with that polarization is, for instance, that it's very advent, the very coming of this polarization has obscured the fact that in what you would call progressive Greece, or at least it's kind of politically progressive Greece, there is still a lot of homophobia, or gender agnosticism, or a number of unresolved issues regarding the politics, gender politics, and the place of gender in politics. The policies announced on this front, for instance, from Syriza, the party, the main party of the left, and the difficulty in publicly supporting these policies are a case in point. Syriza has had some of the most progressive policies in terms of gender, but it does not discuss them in public. It is the only part, I think, of the, its chart that is not actually very much discussed, alongside the issue of the church, the church-state system. These are two big blind spots. Even the migration issues, that are the third blind spot of the Syriza program, are more discussed than the gender and the church-state issues. That shows that all these debate, progressive versus traditionalism, traditional baddies, homophobic traditionalists versus the good pro-queers, actually is much more complicated. The second, why it's more complicated, is that the debate also seems to be taking all the energy from another debate. That debate, the traditionalist baddies versus the queer progressivists, is actually taking all the energy at the moment from another debate that 5-6 years ago was about to happen, and all these new younger movements were about to conduct it, which was the debate between homonormativity and queer modes of belonging and politics. So 5-6 years ago, or even 4 years ago, we were about to have this debate. I mean, how much marriage do we need, and how much homonormativity in Greek society do we need? How much queer eye for the straight eye do we want on the television, and how much queer radicalism is absent and needs to be rethought? You know, it's kind of. A debate against homonormativity was about to be had, and now it's not being had, that's my point, because it is being eaten up by this idea, traditionalism versus queer progressivism, within Greek context and in the crisis context. Last but not least, the fact that traditionalism versus progressivism might obscure, there is also the problem that the traditionalism versus progressivism might obscure the different aspects that the Greek field of gender sexuality performance had taken in the past. That is, the debate as is now in the crisis, the debate between the traditionalist homophobic bodies and the progressively pro-queers, actually is not allowing us, is eating up the space of Greek queer histories. Precisely because it is within traditions that former modes of queer belonging had been had in Greece. I'm losing you? No? Okay. I can explain more about that. This is actually a point I'll be coming back to close the lecture. That was the first point I wanted to make, the first complication I wanted to share with you to complicate the picture of what's happening now. That's the traditional versus progressive debate is eating up space, yeah? Second point I want to make to complicate the picture is the complex marginality of queer theory still evident in Greece. Judith Butler is becoming a huge name in Greece, or at least with people who read. Progressive theory comes to Greece and is being again read in the context of the crisis. This is not a bad thing. But I have a feeling that there is a certain problem with queer theory that relates to central internal problems of the Greek debate, the Greek cultural debate. For instance, the idea that what in queer theory debates we call sex in public, the idea that, you know, there's this idea that you have to, what you do in bed should not be in the public arena. It's been discussed and discussed again and undermined or deconstructed by queer theorists for 15, 20 years. I remind you the central paper, Sex in Public by Warner and Berlan, and the idea there is that actually sex is in public when you're straight. Remember how many politicians actually kiss their wives in public and even in their promotional material and all that. Yeah? Or they discuss how they met their wives, or they met their husbands, and blah, blah, blah. Sex in public is a problem when you're gay. So, in Greece, sex in public is still an issue. This idea that what you do in bed should not enter your politics or should not enter public arena is still in the very center of the debate, yes? And that creates a quite interesting problem even within progressive rhetorics with certain aspects of queer theory. Why do this in the university? As a very close friend, and I should say comrade, told me on the phone as I was coming here, he did talk about something I had recently wrote, and he said, you know, Dimitris, in the end, I like your political writing. I can't tell you about these other things. I always feel this shouldn't enter public debate. The other things are actually 90% of my recent writing, which is queer theory. Yeah, and this is my second problem that somehow, because now we discuss everything in the frame of the crisis, we forget that there are still problems. And the second and a big problem is this kind of complex marginality that we have pushed queer theory to in Greece, and it's still there. It's there's still, in a complex way, marginal queer theory, and may remain so. The third complicating issue I want to share is the suspicion against not only queer theory, but queer cultures. No matter how much people understand now that there is a debate around gender, and this debate is very topical because of the rise of the Golden Dawn and the rise of homophobic attacks and the rise of gender violence, still, what you would call queer culture or sexual cultures is actually seen in with great suspicion. Not only because, again, we have you have the problem of sex in public, you have the problem of this not entering the public arena, but also because there is still an analytics that so insists that it is incompatible with Greekness. Not that certain sexual cultures are incompatible with Greekness, that talking about sexual cultures is incompatible with Greekness. So there's a suspicion against sexual cultures and queer cultures that also should come in play, and please don't forget that. The fourth point I want to make to complicate that kind of picture of the crisis, gender crisis situation, is the complexity of queer gay in Greek queer politics and cultural theory. Now, this is the the rest will be easier. Now, this is the most complicated thing. Now, as many people have remarked, and myself among them, in Greece, even though the genealogy of this is a history I tried to describe to you seems linear, that is that, you know, whatever I was telling you, in the 90s we had this and that, in the year 2000, 2004, people thought we had a new queer Greece and then we had the crisis. Okay, this seems linear. Yet there are a number of issues that show to us there have been huge gaps in the way that we treated gender and sexuality, and we picked up political issues related to gender. Often people who discuss these things do remember that you have peaks and then complete forgetting in terms of big debates around sexuality. You have a peak in the 70s where you have a big, strong movement, homosexual, gay and lesbian movement, very theoretically informed, as a matter of fact. Then you have silence, then you have a number of discussions around specific issues in the 1980s, not in a very nice way, then you have a big silence about AIDS, then you have what I described to you so far. In a sense, every time you have a reinvigoration of the debate about gender and sexuality and a new dynamism for queer expression, every time it seems as if we have the need to reaffirm gay identities and gay debates before we enter, or at least at the same time as we also try to do other things that come with a global kind of discussion about these things. So the point here is that in Greece, if you see the debates, if you see the big arena of fighting about these debates, gay and queer come at the same time, today. So, for instance, a number of gay-related, identity-based debates are being had in such a deep way as if the discussion had never happened, and that's the gay part, and at the same time you have the very queer understanding of identities that are in flux, sexual cultures that are much more playful, and a debate against normativity rather than a debate about identity, yes? Which is the queer side. So, gay and queer come to Greece at the same time every time we pick up the debate, precisely because we haven't resolved the gay thing in the way that, for instance, dominant cultures like the Anglo-Saxon culture or the debate in Germany had done it. So you have the 60s, 70s, it's the gay debates, 80s, then the need for something new comes and the queer debate starts then, yeah? I know it's a generalization, but this is how I see it and many people see it. Well, in Greece you didn't have that. Gay debate never finished, so you have gay. Think about that when you think about what is happening in the crisis. Think about that when you think about how people see the Greek parades, the gay parades and the gay prides. The gay prides in Greece are very interesting precisely because they're an amalgam, they're it's kind of palimpsest of debates. Yeah? They're everything together. And here you go, you have all these palimpsests that has to resolve the gay thing, has to resolve coming out, still coming out, a big thing in Greece. Coming out, huge thing. At the same time, you will see the radicalness of Fita, radical queer performance at the same time. And the radical queers are not against the coming out debate because in Greece, this goes together. They are not there in order to ridicule the people who are there for recognition or who are for stable identities. No, they're together. They actually hang out in the same places. The two lesbian women you saw, actually, in the documentary a couple of hours ago, hung out at a very, in a place that's a very, very queer place, a very queer lesbian place. They're not separated. It's not a separation that one could see, for instance, in France. Okay, that's the, and this is important for me because it is in this kind of, coached in this kind of background that the new huge debate for me, which is the neoliberal gay versus the kind of more queer progressive gay, more queer progressive identity, whatever you call it, anti-neoliberal queer identity, has to be had. It has to be had within this palimpsest, which is already very complex, yeah? And here is my point. It's my last point. It is for all these reasons that I believe that new queer expression in Greece and new queer thinking in Greece should not rest within this kind of easy adversity with traditionalism and homophobia. It is easy because it is being had now in the public kind of more easily than in the past. As we saw with the Courtois debate, and I had like so many examples I haven't shared with you, but okay, I think you're taking my point, so that's okay. It is the fight against homophobia is huge, and it should be hard, and it is there, but somehow, and we thought actually we have to make it stronger and stronger, but then you go, you give a paper, and everybody's clapping, at least our world. You know, it's kind of, It is a good debate to be had, but it's kind of a, I think the big challenge now is not really to give the fight against gender violence and homophobia, because we are giving that fight. The big challenge at the moment, in this context we're talking, is to offer a queer genealogy in Greece. And this is my argument. The big problem in Greece today is not to talk about coming out as gay or to talk about the homophobia of right-wing politics, for instance. The big fight is to say that there was in the 70s a movement that tried to say all this and somehow it was forgotten. Or to pick up those older cultures and see their oxymora or see their diverse... to pick up, for instance, a culture like the Greek Kalyarda culture, that language I talked to you about, which at the moment in the 2000s became a little bit of a new trend. But still, that was a culture, that was a subculture that is perhaps problematic because it was it was the result of a huge oppression, problematic in terms of its understanding of gender because it was very well traditional in the way it thought gender, but it was there. It was there in the 50s and the 60s. The big problem today, the big challenge for new queer thinking in Greece in the context of the crisis is to try to say that's history. Reclaim it in progressive ways. See and discuss its problems, perhaps its limitations, but its new openings. The big problem, the big challenge for new queer expression in Greece today is to talk about what makes a counter-cultural public exist, a counter-public in terms of what Michael Warner calls a counter-public, a public that is, that demands presence in the public sphere in order to do something with that public presence. In order to participate in the political debate, in order to figure out to discuss real issues, to discuss problems, to show problematic foundations. The real challenge for new queer expression in Greece is to talk nationality, to talk national identity, to talk about the problems of national identity, to talk about the problems of thinking of a national identity as a very masculinist project, for instance. So that, for me, is the issue today, as it is today. The way I talk to it is as if I kind of push a little bit, or I kind of marginalize the real fight that has to be had against the kind of homosociality of the Golden Dawn, and at the same time homophobia of the Golden Dawn, or the real fight that needs to be had against a strengthening gender hierarchy that, with the help of right-wing policies, is becoming more and more you know, traditionalist, masculinist, and homophobic. No, that is a big game. That is a fight that has to be had, and we are having that. I'm just saying that let us not forget the complexity of the situation. Let us not once again, like in the year 2000s, go and sail with the ship of how nice things are because everybody can hear us now and everybody is against homophobia, at least there's a big progressive group of people, you know, 50-60% of Greeks are with us and we will legalize gay marriage and all that. And let us not have that kind of elated feeling we had in the mid-2000s, because there are so many other complex issues. And because the challenge, I think, lies somewhere else, like with many other debates we're having in Greece, and some of them have been already shared, the challenge in terms of the queer expression actually, I think, lies with queer genealogies, giving a history, demanding a history, demanding public debates, demanding presence and position in the public sphere, talking about the public sphere and its relation to gender hierarchies. And this is, I think, if you want to talk about new queer Greece and take, or at least kind of valorize, or at least pay tribute to my question mark in my title, there is new queer Greece. If you want to really really ask this question about new queer Greece, I think this is what you have to do, and I think this is what you have to think. It's a turn to history, it's a turn to genealogy, it's a turn to thinking where we stand in all its complexity that I think is a challenge we are facing today. Sorry, I know this was a little bit packed. Please do ask me whatever you didn't understand.
Yeah, please, we'll open up right now. One, two, and... Okay, let's start from here.
No,
please. We're going to have to
listen. So, first of all, thanks a lot. It was a really, really informative, exciting, different layers. I'm not asking a bit about the, let's say, the economics of this analysis, because when you talk about crisis, and you really said that the main manifestation of the crisis is this kind of strengthening of the gender hierarchies. So my talent would be...
No, in terms of gender.
Yeah. On two ways, or from two different directions. On the one hand, I would like you to communicate a little bit your story by referring, let's say, how gender identities or queer subjectivities relate to class or specific economic positions. But I think the more provocative question has to do with somehow repeating this idea of this kind of new queer race spring topic in the 2000s. And how much this relates to this kind of I would say extreme welfare of the Greek middle classes or kind of a race of consumerism or even the possibility to produce cultural work in different fields and how the aims to that.
Okay. There is an easy way to answer this question. These are the two main problems of my analysis. The first problem is that it's very much centered on what was happening and is happening in Athens and to an extent in Thessaloniki. So very, very, the locality is kind of, I'm talking about central cultural representations. And the second is that class is a little bit, is quite absent. Now, so the answer is to say yes, I know the problem. The reason I have left it out still is because also whatever else we do today and in other days here actually has a similar problem, because very much the whole discussion of the crisis is especially crisis and representation is being had with a little bit less focus on the issue of class. This doesn't mean that it doesn't exist. I'll say one thing. The Greek crisis is to an extent the crisis of the Greek middle classes. That's the one thing. And this is a story of the Greek middle classes that I've given you. The second thing I could tell you is that Greece is still quite unified, more unified than other cultures I know in terms of its public sphere. So whatever happens in a certain milieu that's very ethnocentric or Athens and Salonika actually reflects on the country as a whole. And the third thing is that do not underestimate how these debates are being felt. It's basically to show that I'm not sure how I could have this discussion taking class into account fully. Maybe I don't have the analytics. I don't think anyone does at the moment. If no other questions come, I'll tell you the longer answer. But this is the shorter answer.
Can I carry on with that? Well, first of all, thank you for this wonderful presentation. And also, this is perhaps a chance to thank you and congratulate you for not only speaking out about these things, but also doing specific work that construct the very genealogies you were talking about, the missing ones. So it's also a chance to congratulate you on that. The fact that you're doing that, you're doing the dirty job. That's the important thing. Now, while I was listening to you, big dilemma question arose. And this is what I want to share with you and perhaps gain some answer. Is that you suggested that there is some sort of construction of the gay identity in Greece, and gay discourse and gay public sphere, gay publicity, that has negated, neglected, or suppressed or repressed in various ways the queer issue. The queer question, whatever it is.
Can I explain?
Yeah. Whatever. I mean, you sort of spoke of gay stereotypical identities that have at certain points become predominant in such a way that they have suppressed a more radical. Okay. And sort of, there was a point in your lecture that you tried to construe and offer an alternative, a way out of this. And I thought, I'm not very sure that this is your suggestion, but this is what I understood, that you're suggesting that if we somehow articulate the new queer discourse with a certain form of anti-neoliberal discourse, then we may somehow, if not resolve this, step up to the next level of discussion and somehow radicalize the whole issue. I'm not very sure, but this is what I understood. Okay.
And you would now say that the anti-neoliberal is also.
No, but I would say that if gay discourse and gay stereotypical discourse, even the radical one, is full of depressions and never-ending debates and misconceptions, whatever, the anti-neoliberal discourse in Greece is even a bigger, much bigger doubt, in the sense that it is exactly the form of discourse that is full of given content and specific stereotypical articulations.
The anti-memorandum is not the anti-neoliberal, I'll explain.
Oh, no, especially the anti-memorandum. Sorry, before the anti-memorandum, there is a big story of anti-neoliberal discourse. And if it took you almost a decade to map down the genealogy of gay discourse in Greece, then you probably need about three, four, I don't know how many decades to decode what sort of anti-neoliberalism is expressed in either the left wing or right wing tradition.
Okay.
In Greece.
Can I explain? Okay. All right. Also linking the previous question, many of you may have thought, oh, look at him, he hasn't thought class. It's not like that. I just, in the previous question, and in order to, what I said is that the work I'm doing is fully positioned, which means that I acknowledge my position in the way that, for instance, people who organize a gay pride or talk about a gay pride or talk about the importance of a gay pride or talk about the repercussions of a gay pride actually are positioned in the context of it, etc. And nobody, for instance, when you talk with this, the analytics of class are at the moment a little bit behind with this, especially because we're talking about publics, counter-publics, and kind of a national context often that we think of as homogeneous. And this is the problem of the whole debate, so I'm positioning myself very politically in this debate, so I do, to answer to you now, I do take some presuppositions in order to provide my own positionality. Now, in terms of the neoliberal debate and what I said, I just said that because of the crisis and because this kind of tradition versus progress is being had and reflect on gender, we are losing another discussion that was about to happen 3 or 4 years. It's a discussion that was about to happen. I have a position in this discussion. You may have a different one, but it was a discussion, which was, I need to turn this off, which was a discussion about homonormativity, I called it. Homonormativity, yeah? It's the two gay guys well photographed with a dog in the cover of Glossy magazine. That's homonormativity. And as opposed to that kind of new queer expressions that would talk about, amongst other things, deconstructing the neoliberal subject, a neoliberal subject that I find sometimes very much central in the left-wing politics at the moment. So, for instance, many left-wing parties still accept a neoliberal subject in the center, and that's a problem, yes, for me. So I think that this was a debate to be had. A debate, for instance, to say, okay, how do you talk about gay marriage in Greece? For instance, I'm pro-gay marriage in Greece, very pro-gay marriage, because of the debates that it could bring with it. Because it's about the public sphere. Yes, that's gay marriage is about the public sphere. In Greece, specifically, very much, because I know the country, I know the context. I'm pro. At the same time, I want this to be also a debate against the neoliberalism of the wedded subject, you know, or whatever, of the big glossy magazines that would come with it, that would be, you know, marriage for gay or whatever, or how to make your wedding a better wedding and all that. You know, I want this to be a debate. Now, I don't think Staphylakis' position is that you can never escape the essentialism of these positions, and that the deconstructing the neoliberal subject is already a position that is problematic also within the. I don't believe that, but it's a big debate.
We have other questions because I would also like to make a remark.
Oh, I've got two small examples. To just in 5 years ago, I was in the Gay Pride in the Euro Gay Pride in Zurich, and this is the big year when there was an anti-gay pride, because in Zurich it was so much taken by its kind of central capital organization, capitalist whatever enterprises. So it was like half of the parade was this huge thing organized by the big banks. So Barclays had a huge thing, and HSBC had a big other things, and many people, and they paid for certain parties to be had in the city and all that. And there was the first anti-pride. And this is what I'm saying about the debate that we're not having in Greece at the moment, just because of this other context. So there was this anti-pride, which was a very queer thing, with an anti-demonstration against the Euro Pride and the kind of capitalist organization of it. So this is what, in very simple terms, this is what I meant, okay? The second example I wanted to tell you, to just illustrate a little bit the need for history, the need for history within the context of the current crisis that I told you, is perhaps, and the complexity of it, and the traditionalist complexity of it, and the class complexity of it, just to address class even just at the last minute, is the Paula Project. I don't know, is anybody knowledgeable of the Paula Project? Has anybody seen the Paula Project? Yeah, the Paula Project. Now, Paula is a very interesting figure, herself history, a very uneven history. Is one of the big figures in the kind of the big, what used to be called travesti in Greece, in like a little bit like in Brazil, the what you would call today, I don't know, transsexual sex workers, who in the 70s and 80s suddenly became very visible, themselves part of a much more traditional sexual economy, who though did talk identity in the 80s. Paula, among them, was published her own magazine for a little while, had debates on television, sometimes uneven herself. And then today, with very simple means, actually shoots documentaries, which she then publishes online. One of the documentaries is on Kalyarda, that language, and those of you who have Greek should watch that documentary. It's a great. Another one is a talk she has with, a discussion she has with three young gay men. It's a little bit, the problem with Paula is that I don't think she ever sees lesbians. I don't think she believes they exist. But anyway, that's why I'm saying it's all complicated. But for Paula, class does exist. And in those cheap documentaries she has, she brings up a very rich history of Greek queer belonging and emotional attachment with which you don't identify. Nobody does. You don't identify, but But it's very political, especially because you don't identify, but somehow it is part of your political project if you're queer. It's my only way to address class would be that, for instance. The way I watch those Paola documentaries that do address class, among other things. And it is this kind of richness and thirst for queer history and its complexity that I wanted to, in this kind of, I understand, very peculiarly complex lecture, I wanted to flesh out, to share with you. I mean, the Paola Project is a good example to see that, and also a good example to see this, both my need to say what I said about neoliberalism and its limits, as you pointed out.
I just about this, about the genealogy. You have right. Also, I would like to tell the words of the woman that I saw before, that I couldn't put it in the final cut. They also expressed their bitterness about this lack of a continuity or of knowledge about the previous fights and struggles of the lesbians and queers, and it was it's very obvious this, and it would help the next generation, and this, they are alone, there is a background, no one knows, they make very certain stories, they said, about, for example, a theatrical performance. That it was stories of lesbian women that at 90s make a big scandal, and it was a very tragic thing, and no one cares anything about this, and someone must talk about this. But also they express, they hope that the new generation are more educated, more ready, and they are doing this work of reading and writing this history.
I'm interested in ideas of creative labour and how creative workers exist, basically. And I'm quite curious about your analogy in kind of how queer culture or queer theory is this a way of interpreting a crisis. And I wonder, outside of Greece, where you see other models existing in other post-European crisis countries such as the UK, Ireland, Italy, Spain. And are there specific conditions in Greece that are allowing for this transition to occur, or are these changes also moving around in other countries as well?
To answer the second question first, maybe you know more about that than I do. My experience in do you want the honest answer or I've got a complex theoretical answer in my mind that I can give you afterwards. I understand you are very much au courant, so I can tell you the complex one. But the simple one is that in countries like Greece, the debate is about fundamentals still, and it's much about the public sphere. So it's also about belonging. In countries like Britain, perhaps France, the debate has now moved on in ways that would be the subject of a different discussion. Perhaps has now moved to intersectionality and the need for constant intersectionality. In Greece, while we also have that, so how issues are related, yes, who can be this and that. In Greece, I mean, you still fight for fundamental fight for which is a public sphere fight, and I think this is the point. Also in Greece. At the moment, in those countries, I don't know about other countries of the South so much, but in Greece at the moment, you haven't got homonormativity at the highs that you have it in the US, for instance, of the UK. And this is interesting to see how homonormativity now is coming up. That is this kind of normative, more capitalist, more neoliberal understanding of sexual identity is still more debatable, just because it is not, things can happen, like people, a big left newspaper can still review your book, your queer theory book, talking about how you may be a university professor, but you play the flute a lot, as they did recently reviewing a book of mine. And then I had to write back and demand that the newspaper publish my thing in the first page, which they did, because there are people who understand what's the stake, but still you have to give that kind of fight, that kind of relentless undermining of any idea that a sexual identity culture and a counterpublic could demand its political its political semantics, its political power, its political importance, which I think is not anymore debated in Britain, for instance. The debate is a little bit different. So when homonormativity comes in both Britain and Greece, it's interesting to see how it comes in Greece, because it also comes in a context that is still unreconstructed in some things. I understand that other countries have a similar issue. Now, in terms of the thirst for history, yes, the thirst for history is there, and it's, for me, it's very interesting. So people still do ask very central things, you know, who was this, that, what was this magazine. They don't, for instance, know the kind of the history of the gay movement in Greece, how it was related in the 60s, 70s, and the 70s to other movements around the world. And they want to know it, and they say all this. And I find it very interesting, not because it is a thirst for history to court, but because it addresses an issue that's much more general in the Greek case, and perhaps should be addressed in your other panels as well, which is the gaps, which is a public history problem. It is a public sphere problem. That is, you have a debate, you resolve it somehow, and then you stop talking about it. So that's why genealogy now in Greece is such a radical thing. Just because, even any, apart from perhaps the history of the left-wing movement, which also has problems, apart from that, most of the other debates have been with big gaps, including the queer debate, whatever it happened. So a thirst for history now addresses a bigger thing for Greece. A thirst for queer history addresses the thirst for challenging the gaps, which is a public sphere issue. Yeah.
So I will take the word and there's quite a few things I would like to remind, but I try to keep it short because we have to pass to the next 4 months. But you mentioned, for example, as I understood it, the issue of mainstreaming queerness. Which is, to my opinion, a thing that we can observe in different contexts and not only in Greece, this kind of mainstreaming the queer identities. And this I find really interesting if we compare it, like if we still want to stay in the Greek case phenomenon and so on, because you somehow said, okay, it's the queer attitudes or the queer cultures. And then you focus on the gay cultures, and somehow from this spectrum is always the women, the lesbian, and the trans missing, also in this mainstreaming. Whereas this is also the case in let's say, other contexts outside of Greece, but this is another issue. The other thing is, by talking on queer identities or queer cultures, okay, you did also the differentiation. There's a queer theory that is also taking place in Greece, in the academia, which is, okay, it is there, but it's not a big, let's say, it's not a big soup. And the other thing is there are like the queer attitudes, the things that people, perform every day in the queer cultures, which is really very present, and we have these two things but taking place at the same time, like in the art, in the cultural context, and then also in the political context, the activism. And at some point you had two or three velocities of things taking place. But my question is, as I experienced it like last year when we had like a workshop on within the framework of a queer festival in Greece at the Ambrosiator. And I was asking like in the performance, what is queer for you? So I was in the context of a queer festival in Greece, and I was asking I don't want to say so many things about the performance, but the main question was, what is queer for you now in Athens, or in queer festival? And I have the impression that there is so many things that they are totally open at that point, and so many, at some point, stereotypes, at some point, homonormativity, as you said, at some point, things that maybe have been discussed in the 80s, and then you also saw that very nice that you have this, let's say, this historical development of a discourse, and then at some point it became mainstream, and then we forget the other things. And so I was interested just to end my long statement. Where would you see now things that are not going towards mainstreaming, because this is the thing that we can see everywhere, so it's not, let's say, a Greek phenomenon, and I don't want to talk in these terms, but where we can see now in the new queer cultures, in the theory, in the practice, in the activism, in their intersectionality also, where would we see like the cross borders, for example, with post-colonialism, critical whiteness, the other things that are out there and they don't get addressed somehow?
Yeah. Okay, the last bit. Sophia said is the meat here, is what I tried to say. History, genealogy, intersectionality is the big challenges. The problem in Greece is that they are trying to push us to a position of an activist rights discourse and give us those rights just to us, I don't know, Greeks, I don't know, white Greeks, men perhaps, just to the specific and end the debate once again. This is my anxiety, and this is what I'm fighting against, and Staphylakis, I think, pointed to that, and thank you. Because this is exactly what, for instance, this is what I'm trying to do from every corner. Let's not end once again the debate just by giving some kind of space to some people. Intersectionality, for instance, the idea of talking about sexual identity, national identity, and colonialism, and new forms of colonialism, is still not very open. You know, this kind of, and also a number of other things. Constantly, the linking is the problem. To connect these discussions is the problem. So that's my issue. Now, because, so that was the answer to half of Sophia's statement. The answer to the first half, as to part of the questions that were asked before, is an apology. And the apology is a positionality apology. Because in Greece, we have this kind of palimpsest that I've been describing, a palimpsest in which you have to, at the same time, be gay and queer. That is, talk about issues that are still belonging to the gay, stable identity type of sphere, such as, for instance, identity issues, identity rights. And at the same time, do the very progressive queer discussion. This is why often I find myself becoming the white gay man, talking like I would be talking in the 70s, that is, forgetting women, I don't know, forgetting issues of color, class, etc. Because you get positioned in this way. in order to have the discussion, to be some, and then at the same time, and this is the problem. And don't forget something, the reason often progressive, or at least radical queer thinking is itself male-centered, is also because patriarchy is everywhere and comes even in our minds and fucks us up already. Okay, one, and I'm very much a problem with that. Okay, but also because of the very, very problematic relationship between manhood and national identity. And because the fight is still on in Greece, basically everybody who is fucked is not Greek. Yeah, everybody who is less of a man and then is less of a Greek, and because all these other, there's a lot going on there, and you have to push so much. That is why often our analysis comes, and even the queer analysis, and even queer performers in Greece, much more than in other countries, are male-centered. Still, in a kind of unreconstructed way, lesbianism is debated differently in Greece, even today, just because so much is at stake with male gay performance. So there's an issue of public, public national presence that is so much related to manhood. There's so much at stake when one undermines traditional versions of male identity and its link to national belonging that make us sometimes. Basically participate in a project that makes even queer analysis a little bit part of the canon, and by doing that you forget so much else, and you replicate marginalizations. Having said that, some of the most important work at the moment is being done in Greece by lesbian theorists, and the thirst with which Judith Butler is being read, or Rosie Braidotti is today giving a lecture in Greece, and you name it, everybody goes and is being. More their political stuff, like my friend would tell me, they like the Judith Butler of precarious lives, not the Judith Butler of gender trouble in Greece, but still. And so, I don't know if this was a very open way to, I don't know, I thought it was.
This is a question, but as I very much liked the comparison and this palimpsest idea of people having to use both gay, stable identity discourse and queer, I will only add an example for boy. It's a personal example, but not to tell you my personal story, just because of the, because that this example fits in this description. I too, as many people here, took part in this queer festival at the Bose Theater last year. And I tried to use queer theory in relation to national identities. To make a very long story short, I just claimed that a specific ethnic group, Pont Greeks, showed a queerness in the way they managed their identity being both Greeks and not being Greek, keeping a separate identity. This remark was not at all welcome by both Ponti Greeks, of course, who have a very masculinist culture. And there was one guy who said, "You're racist because you attribute to us Ponti Greeks." Actually, he said, "You're calling us faggots," and he was very insulted by that. But also, I had very negative reactions by people identifying themselves as queer. And I have the impression, I was surprised by that. I had the feeling that I was prolonging their experience and using their tools to think about something else than sexual identity. But I have the impression that people reacted negatively because I translate their reaction as
you're not one of us. Are you gay or straight? If you're not, if you're straight, how come can you use the queer analytical tools? Because it's our thing, it's our toy. Don't take our toy from us. Maybe I'm wrong, but I have this impression, and the idea put forward by Dimitris can explain this. It fits with that, and so I'm trying to rethink this experience in this light.
Because of the palimpsest. I always use this Gayatri Spivak statement where she says, I gave my life to, I'm approximated, I don't remember it word for word, but she says, I gave my life to make postcolonialism, you know, widely known and widely discussed and, at universities, but now I'm sick of white, tall white boys studying postcolonialism. You know, it's a little bit, there is this issue where you see your both activist, political, and analytical, at the same time, discourse becoming a metaphor. Yes, so if you say that, for instance, Bouzouki music is queer, Melina Mercouri Bouzouki music is queer, or whatever. I once took a grant to sort of study all the dresses that Melina Mercouri wore during the her career in France. You know, it's kind of because I thought this was a very queer thing to do. You know, it's kind of, then it's becoming a metaphor, and this is not bad because it's analytically very sound. But still, when you have the palimpsestic situations that I described, and with this I will finish, you get people who say, look, guy, this is about our lives. This is about, you know, our family oppressing us, or this is about, you know, the inability to talk class and sex together, or the inability to even think what's happening at the moment in small villages in Greece in terms of gender, because we have never debated that. We've never, this kind of sexual identity still is very, what happens to young lesbian women? You know, this is a small place where I come from. Even last year I heard a story of extreme gender violence against a lesbian girl, and then I tried to talk to her and then she said nothing had happened because I'm not a lesbian. And then I thought, okay, look, there is a huge thing there. And so the fight about school education should go on, democratization of sex education, gender theory, more available to people, and all that should go on. And then I can understand people who feel kind of uneasy when they see queer now becoming a metaphor. Because they think that there are other issues that haven't been resolved, so but still, it should become a metaphor. I mean, thank God you did this paper about queer politics. Because the palimpsest should work. This is the only way we could do that. We should have fita, and we should also have a debate about gay marriage. And we should have fita now, and thanks for coming, and thank you. Ah.
Yeah, because only one, you know, it's going to... We have a last one.
One sort of remark or question, I don't know, and then we will go to the car and then you have to take your chair with you. But please stay seated.
The last thing I want to say is about the gap, discussing the gaps. I think we should put attention in the critical historical analysis of the Masson first governance of how that was influenced the gay pride movement, and then we must find a way that analysis to take it and see how we can prevent it now with the so maybe the governance of Syriza, and if such a governance would do a second gap.
Okay. I don't, yeah. It's my question whether a left governance in Greece, if it ever happens, and if it's not very short, which I fear it will be very, very short if it ever happens. But I don't know if a left-wing government will change things very much, but PASOK, indeed, as a socialist government in the 80s, and she's pointing at a very real situation here, did this very, very, very central thing in which it did honor demands by various groups and various basically movements without honoring their position in the public sphere. So in Greece, if you take one after the other, the basic, very neat, very, very structural demand or very pressing demands by feminist groups, gay groups, sex workers groups, you name it, in the 80s were actually honored by the socialist government. So life became better for everyone. At the same time, there was no acknowledgement of any position. Actually, they were silenced. Feminist movements became a joke at the same time as kind of feminist agendas implemented even in government. Yeah? Gay politics became an unthinkable thing to do within our culture, our political culture, at the same time in which, for instance, all the homophobic legislation was actually repealed, and AIDS was the very, HIV/AIDS was the very thing that was never mentioned, never, never, ever, at the same time as the actual medication and medical provision was one of the best in Europe. You would get your medical support as a price for not speaking out, basically. And this is for me a good metaphor to see the PASOK and post-PASOK government and what it did, and perhaps it will change. And now to FITA.